Hi guys, welcome back to my channel. And first of all, before we start today, I just want to say thank you so much for all the love and support and mostly understanding that I got on my last video. I was so surprised and I was super, super nervous just about the response that it would get. That's why it's probably taken me a while to put this next video out, because I felt so overwhelmed with emotions and it kind of threw me off kilter. I don't know what was going on, but it kind of threw me off a little bit. But I am so, so thankful, and I've tried to keep up with all your comments, all your messages on my Instagram, and it just honestly, it fills me with so much love. So thank you so much. So today's video is going to be about how I write songs. I really wanted to give you guys a bit of a backstory to some of like my biggest pop songs that I've had, stories that you guys have never heard before, I'm gonna share with you today. And also, I was thinking that this would kind of be like a two-part video. So let me know in the comments if you wanna see a second part to it, because I don't feel like it's enough to sort of explain my method of doing things. I feel like I kind of need to show you. So make sure you guys hit subscribe right now so that you'll know when I'm dropping that next video. So writing for me sort of started when I was about, I would like to say 11 years old, in just form of poetry. I kind of fancied myself as a bit of a rapper, and this is so embarrassing, but in my mind, I felt like, you know, I was a female Kano, and so I started to write all my thoughts on paper, and I would always, it always had to rhyme. Back then I was like, yeah, I'm gonna write these poems, write these rhymes, and I'm gonna call them raps. I literally thought of it like, I like to sing and I like to write. It was two separate things. Didn't even really put the pieces together until I was in the Sugababes in the early years, and we were working on our very first album called One Touch, and I met a producer called Cameron McVeigh. And in the session, he was sort of like talking to us about, you know, songwriting, whether we did it or not. And I was kind of like, well, I don't really like write songs, but I write raps. And I remember I brought in sort of like my book and showed him, and he was like, he looked and was like, but you know, you just put melody to this and it's basically a song. And so from that point there, it was just like my mind just exploded. I wanted to just write all the time and add melody. So I was able to do two of the things that I loved. I think one of the first verses that I ever wrote was a song called New Year. And I remember just like starting the verse off, like sitting here stressing at 2:30 a.m. About how fast the year can go. I wonder where it went. I remember in my head, I thought, oh, okay, it's raps with melody. So there wasn't anything connected to it other than that, until we did the song Run for Cover. At that time, we were doing private tuition, so we weren't really around our friends anymore. But then we were put into adult environments and expected to sort of be like adults, but really we were kids. And I think my head was like, a lot of the times, in a lot of, you know, confusion. And so I remember just writing about that. Now, as I said before, we had gotten private tuition and we weren't around any of our friends as much. And I felt really lonely at times, because I felt like when I was around my friends, I couldn't really relate to them and they couldn't relate to me. Our conversations were very different. I felt like I was a lot more immature than they were. They were having real life experiences, you know, with boys and just things like that. And I just kind of felt very alienated from everyone, and for so many different reasons. And I remember going to my mum, just being really upset, really down. And my mum was like, you know, you have to learn to enjoy your own company. You're gonna go through things sometimes, you're gonna feel this way, but you're gonna overcome it, you know, ultimately, just like keep the faith, basically. I remember going into the studio and there was a chorus that was written. The chorus was like, I'm all alone and finally I'm getting stronger. And I remember hearing it and going, ah, and I was like really feeling very like empowered that day. And so when I approached my verse, I remember feeling like I needed to just express everything how everything I was feeling, I was so conscious of that. I ended up going in and writing, and my verse was, sometimes I feel so down and out, like emotions that have been captured in a maze.
Like emotion that's been captured in a maze.
I have my ups and downs, downs, trials and tribulations. I overcome them day by day. Feeling good and almost powerful, a new me.
Feeling good and almost powerful.
Once I got it out, I just felt so much better. I remember my songwriting started to change, and it was around the time where I started sort of discovering boys a lot more, and the song Push the Button was a prime example of that. But we spent a lot of time in Atlanta, and we were recording our album Taller in More Ways, and I remember there was a guy in the studio who shall remain nameless. And there was a guy in the studio, and I remember we just had a really cool connection, and I guess like we had these crushes on each other, and we just always kept in contact. And I just remember one time when we flew back to Atlanta, he wanted to take me on a date. And so we went on this date, and of course everyone sort of knew about it and was sort of making fun of us, like, oh, you're going on the date, you know, that kind of thing. And I think he may have told a few people, so it kind of like, you know, everyone knew where I was going. And so the next day I go into the studio, and we were working with Dallas Austin, and the kind of relationship I always had with Dallas was sort of like, you know, your older brother poking you or making fun of you, and just, it was just full of banter. And I remember I walked in and he was like, oh, so how was your, you know, how was your date? And I was like, fine. And he was like, oh, okay. And he was like playing on the keys. So he started freestyling, and his freestyle was like, Keisha went on a date, like that kind of thing. And of course, like being the extraness that I am, I was like, and he was so cute. And we were kind of going back and forth like that. He started playing this, dun, 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 dun. And again, he's still bantering with me. And he was like, I bet you wanted him to push your button, eh? And I was just like, push my button. He's not gonna push my button. He's gonna push the button. Don't wanna push the button, you know, that kind of vibe. And it just started going, it started creating this sort of back and forth between us. And it just started going from literally us bantering into push the button. And it was this freestyle that came about because of, you know, my crush. And I remember just feeling like, that's exactly how I feel right now. Because I was also getting quite a few mixed signals. It's like I knew that we had a crush on each other, but he wasn't really saying it. And I don't think I was being completely clear either. And so from there, the song developed. And actually, do you know what? I remember, so there's a part of the song where this, like, there's this like a freestyle by me where I'm like talking all seductively, like, you know, oh, I can't even say it. I'm not gonna say it because it's just too embarrassing. And I remember at the time I felt super, super embarrassed, and Alice was like, just go in there, like, you know, imagine he's in front of you and just say how you feel. So what you're hearing me say is literally, I didn't write it down. I literally just went from how I felt, kind of underneath a lot of scrutiny, and the girls were cracking up and just like, it was just mortifying. But it made for a really good pop song, and you know, it did amazing, amazing things. So that was another example of how I was able to connect my actual life experiences to, you know, my lyrics. And now I want to talk about melodies versus lyrics. So I feel like melodies are really, really important, and I'm probably going to get screamed at by some songwriters down below in the comments, but I really feel like a melody is something that can be emotive. It can make you feel certain things. I feel like I listen to lyrics too, of course, but I really get drawn in to melodies. I feel like lyrics can be interpreted in so many different ways. And of course, they're so, so powerful and very, very important. But there's something about the melody that really does capture me. And I often start most of my songwriting with just a handheld mic.
Little,
down a ton of melodies and just layer them up. I feel like my melodies come from gospel music, 90s R&B music. When I was a kid, the things that registered to me the most was how a song was structured, the melody behind it. One of the things that really helped me was to just write from my own perspective, write whatever I felt. And sometimes I would just make things up and just like, I would call like an apple an orange in a nutshell. Let me give you an example. There's a song called Blue that the Sugababes did. And I remember we were just kind of in the studio and everyone was looking for a title for the song before we started. And I was like, oh my gosh, why don't we call it Blue? And people were looking at me like, what do you mean? Like the color blue. I'm like, no. Like, you know, when people act like a certain way, when people act like shady, and this was my teenage mind, when people act shady and when they're hating on you, you know, they're acting blue. And literally like the non-cool people in the room, I'm saying that because they were like 100 years older. I'm sure they were very cool, but you know what I mean? They were like, oh yeah, blue. And the only person who really kind of looked sideways at it was like, I think Lydia looked and was like, because no one in our neighborhood said blue. I mean, no one ever said, oh, that girl over there, look at her, like she's acting blue. No one ever said that. But as far as I was concerned, I was just gonna wing it and see what was gonna happen. And so everyone went along with it and we got away with it basically. So you can literally write songs from a place of just bizarreness, but as long as it means something to you and as long as you're feeling it, that's all that matters. Like writing really should just come from a place of authenticity. So as I said earlier, when I was talking about the song Stronger, you know, I talked about connecting, you know, my emotions to the lyrics that I wrote, but then life started to happen and I started to go through some real tough times in, you know, my adult life. And I ended up having to box emotions away. So that was my coping mechanism. To sort of get through, you know, whatever it was I was getting through. If I felt very overwhelmed, I literally was like, deep breath, leave it over there and unpack things, you know, bit by bit. The issue with that was that when I wanted to write songs, I felt blocked and I couldn't, every time I would think about, okay, this song makes me think about, I don't know, a breakup or love or whatever, I had to go into that box and unpack that and then try to write. And it would just, the whole box would fall out basically, all the bones, everything else would fall out onto the floor and then it would just stop me from doing it. And so I actually have had a lot of struggle over the years to kind of home in and write the way I did when I was younger. It used to come so quickly to me. And then I spoke to my therapist and she was like, have you ever thought of doing like a non-send letter? But it's like, you know, if you're about to write a song and then a particular thought pops in your mind or an experience, you just write about how you feel, just get it out on paper and you don't have to actually send it to the person or ever even read it again, really. But the action of writing something, getting something out will help you to be creative. And I don't know why that didn't come to mind because I've actually kept diaries since I was 14 years old and I decided to write a letter to a particular someone and I just got everything out. And the track that I was sent from the producer, the moment I went back to the track to write on it, it flowed so much quicker and I was like, ah. So that being said, one thing that I'll say is that when it comes to songwriting, for me, boxing isn't great. I do believe that it's helped me. However, if I'm a creative, not so much. So I am learning how to box a little bit, but not everything. And if you're trying to songwrite and you feel blocked, maybe part of you feeling blocked is to do with some of the things that you're kind of, you know, keeping inside that you don't want to approach. So that's sort of my method on how I've written songs in the past and how I intend to move forward with my songwriting. And I hope you guys have enjoyed this video. Like I said in the beginning, I will be dropping a part two. I'm actually gonna show you, you know, how I really get down. And I'll be having a special guest on. So make sure you guys hit subscribe so you know when that video is dropping. And give me a thumbs up if you've enjoyed this video. Please let me know what else you want to see. And I hope you guys are still staying safe. Remember, we get better, not bitter.